We're going to be talking now about agriculture, and particularly the future of sustainable landscape management, with NGOs, traditional business, disruptive innovation backgrounds, therefore the whole, a good part of the spectrum when it comes to understanding the scale. Is this about making current systems more efficient and viewing things in a different way to embed sustainability across different aspects? Or do we need radical innovation, moving away from traditional approaches and looking towards urban agriculture and scientific advancement? Of course, there's nothing new to this debate. We're just going to do a stock take today and find out what has changed in the last few weeks, few days, few months, and the way things are moving. Are things slowing down? Are things speeding up in terms of the direction of travel and the challenges, particularly if 70% more food is needed to be produced globally by 2015 to feed a population of over 9 billion? Right, who do we have up on the panel? We have on the far left, Lars Skodaga Sorensen, welcome. Head of Harvesting Product Management at New Holland Agriculture. Then Marek Tacek, who's President and Chief Executive Officer of the Nature Conservancy here. We have Olivier Dubois, who's Head of Energy at the UN Food and Agricultural Organization, the FAO. And we have Patrick Brown, Chief Executive Officer of Impossible Foods. Now, each of them is going to talk for 3 to 4 minutes, 3 to 5 minutes, but I said to Patrick, first off, just tell us about Impossible Foods, because it's not just any old title, and I see you've just raised a vast amount of cash. I hear it says 108 million for your plant-based burgers, but you say it's 186 million?
100 million tubes, is that right?
Okay, use the microphone here. But just before I get into what you want to pitch in your remarks, just tell us about Impossible Foods.
In a nutshell, we're a startup based in California whose mission is to completely replace animals in the food system and eliminate the world's most destructive industry, animal farming, by making the most delicious, affordable meats in the world directly out of plants.
How easy was it to raise 182 million?
It was one of the easier parts of the job. We're the industry that we are going after, the market we're going after, is $1 trillion annual revenues. So that's an attractive business proposition for investors.
Even if you're called Impossible Foods, does it feel like an impossible project?
Oh, it's absolutely, without a doubt, going to succeed.
Okay, right, we'll hear more of that. That's your taster. Right, stick around because we'll hear more from Patrick shortly. Lars, let's hear your view of the way agriculture is moving and what the challenges are we still need to be talking about.
Sure, and thank you very much, Nick. And first of all, thank you for being here. It's a great pleasure to be here as, let's say, part of the industry that delivers equipment to farmers all over the world. We find us, it's a very, very good for us to be here and exchange ideas with other members of the industry. So thank you very much. And as you said, agriculture faces a daunting challenge today. We need to feed 9 billion people within a very, very short time. At New Holland, we believe that it is our responsibility to address these needs in a very sustainable way. And for us, innovation is the key to meet these objectives. Innovation is making it possible to do more with less. And this is not future stuff we're talking about. It's something we're already doing today. And in this, we have the full backing of CNH Industrial, which is a worldwide group that has achieved ample recognition as a global leader to fight climate change already today. And just to mention a couple, this year, Dow Jones Sustainability Index named us, or CNH Industrial, industry leader within the group. CNH Industrial actions and strategy to fight climate change has also been recognized in the Carbon Disclosure Program on the list, Class A list. And one of the guiding principles within New Holland's clean energy leader strategy is about pursuing more efficient agriculture. So back to your original question, do we need to be more efficient or we need to revolutionize? We are looking to become more efficient in what's already going out there today. And just to give you an idea of the progress we've made over the last year, I don't know if all of you noticed, but outside there was a big tractor sitting. That's one of our products. And this tractor, we have actually been able to reduce emissions, NOx and particulate matter, 180 times over the last two decades. So it's not 180%, but 180 times less pollutant than it was only 15 years ago. Also, we've reduced carbon footprint on a lot of our equipment, and we'll continue to work in this direction. Back in the 1900s, agricultural mechanization was the revolution, and we still had a lot of areas of the world where we have some work to do on this, where we can do more efficient land use, we can increase productivity, we can increase labor use without improving or making our carbon footprint worse. In this century, precision farming presents the next big wave of growth opportunity. It's a second important revolution in agriculture, and it'll make farmers capable of improving their production by having a full disclosure, full transparency of everything they do. By using products like New Holland Precision Land Management, they'll be able to track everything they do in the field. They'll be able to monitor their exact position in the field. They'll be able to apply fertilizer, pesticides, seeds, everything else more precise. And we are expecting savings of all the inputs between 5 to 20% within the near future. And we're not only talking fuels, we're also talking fertilizer, which is very, very big in terms of carbon need. And this is only beginning. There's a continuous evolution in this field, and we have just seen the very, very beginning of this. So it is absolutely sure we can make farming more efficient. It's not a dream. It's happening. At the same time, on a third front, we also look to look at the energy consumption of agriculture, which is today very high. And we are working on the, the machines to be able to do that. We're working with methane fuel tractors. We have been working with hydrogen-powered tractors. But now we are mainly working on the methane side. And it is our vision to have energy-independent farms. And again, we have a project running. In northern Italy, we have a farm that is totally self-sufficient in terms of energy. The tractors are there, it's very real, and we are moving forward in this direction. So, are we able to feed the planet or 9 billion people? The answer is absolutely yes. And we are capable of doing that in a more sustainable way than we are today. And a lot of the technology, as heard a lot of other speakers say the same thing, a lot of the technology is already here. Of course, we need to make further improvements, but implementation of the technology is key. Not only having it, but we also need to be able to implement it. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Lars. One question already to help fashion the rest of your remarks. What one or two key actions would you like to see all large end-use purchasers take, which would collectively accelerate sustainability in agriculture, forestry, and or water use? That from Jason Pearson. And do send notes to me, comments, the usual addresses. I will say it again, it's up in the top left-hand corner on all your screens, question@COP21Paris, or one word, .org, or alternatively via the Twitter address as well. Right, let me move on. Oliver Dubois, your view on how challenging this still is.
Right, I think we have to see food security in an integrated challenge together with water availability and energy availability and production. So it is, if you look at it today, the whole agri-food chain consumes about 30% of available energy. And a lot of it is fossil fuel. If you follow the conventional pathway of developing agri-food chain, so that's a lot. Did wonders before, now we need to change because of climate change. 70% of the available water is used for agriculture. 25% of the land is degraded. So big challenges there, climate change doesn't help. And that's today. Now, if you look at the projections by 2050, we will need 60% more food, 40% more water, and 40% more energy if we follow business as usual. And the problem is we will need these things simultaneously. So we need to do more with less. I think Lars mentioned it. And we, at FAO, we started by saying, let's develop a way that you can assess the pressure, the nexus pressure, so the pressure in terms of food, water, land, energy, but also capital and jobs at a country level, territorial level, but also in terms of investments. And then you need to compare the investments against the context. So that's kind of knowledge, that where do we stand? But I would like to mention a couple of examples where about innovations, but they are not always the same. If you take a simple technology like irrigation, so energy for irrigation, technology is well known, that's not an issue. The problem is, in many places, people give governments give energy for free because they say farmers need to produce enough food, so we need to make energy available. That leads to often very inefficient use of energy, overuse of water, so you deplete the ground basis of water, but also the energy utilities lose money. So some states said, okay, let's change that. We put meters in terms of to price energy. That was okay, but poor farmers could not afford any more energy. So a nexus approach would say, okay, let's have a smart subsidy. You have free energy for the minimum amount of food you need to produce. The rest, if you want to produce more, you pay for energy. But also, let's look at reducing water leaks in the water canals, the irrigation canals. That's not a problem from a water point of view because the water goes back into the cycle. But it's a problem from an energy point of view because you need more water to produce the same amount of, more energy to produce the same amount of water. So let's do that. But also let's look at combining perennial crops with annual crops, so diversifying the crops, more adapted crops for dry conditions. So you need to, it's not a technical issue, it's often the farming system, it's the financial system, the institutional setup. Another example, biogas, very well-known technology, large-scale, small-scale, name it. 40 million household biogas in China have been developed. China is actually moving away from this household level because it's they gave 40% subsidies upfront, not very smart because farmers can then do whatever they want. They use, they don't use the biogas, it's there, it's built. And it often has, the technology is not very good. So now China is moving to industrial biogas, but also middle range biogas systems where the farmers do what they do best, they farm. The energy bit is done by companies that know how to do biogas. So the companies buy this manure, then they produce the biogas, they sell back the fertilizer, which is a byproduct of the biogas, and the biogas to the households. So that's an interesting scheme. And also in some places in China, the farmers actually become, they lend money to the company to buy pigs, and then they get a dividend from the sales of the pigs. So they become part of, like, shareholders of the companies. Very interesting schemes, not a technical issue, more what is non-technical. Moving on to something which we've been, it's been with us, let's say, for 10 years more, this debate, food and fuel. It's complex, but again, people tend to oversimplify complexity, and what we say, you need to embrace complexity for the water, energy, food nexus, but biofuels in particular. People say food-based biofuels is bad. Not true. Not always true. Sugarcane, ethanol in Brazil, you can produce both food and fuel, and investments in increasing the yields of sugarcane came from ethanol, not from the sugar demand. So again, energy crops are always good. Second generation biofuel, not necessarily true, because you need land to produce that stuff. Or residues are the panacea. No, because the residues are often used as fertilizer, soil protection, or animal feed, especially for small-scale farmers in developing countries. So it's not easy, but we need to embrace complexity. One last thing I wanted to mention is insects, possible role, that's very new. Insects, possible role to feed people and address climate change. It's not new for 2 billion people who consume insects on a regular basis, but insects are very rich in proteins, lipids, and all what we need to feed ourselves. But more interestingly, it's also a very interesting source of feed for animal. So if you can use insects and you then reduce the amount of soybean, for example, which is produced, and so you may have an indirect reduction of pressure on land because insects can feed on manure, rubbish, name it. So you feed, it goes like this, the cattle, let's say the animals produce the manure, you rear your insects. Insects are then fed back to that, the same cattle or other cattle. The rest of the manure can be used for compost, biogas, name it. So that's an interesting option, and it reduces the pressure and the footprint of environmental footprint of livestock. But there is a risk, because, and I will finish with that, if the manure comes from cows that have eaten a lot of stuff full of chemicals, then it goes to the insects and goes back to the cattle and to us. So in South Africa, a French company has decided to use arid land to produce organically thornless cacti. They chop down the cacti, give it to the animals. The animals, then the cycle starts again. But you are sure that you get insects that don't get any pesticides or chemicals. So I'll stop here.
Are we good at embracing complexity? I'm just throwing back that phrase you use quickly.
Yes, no. We are not good. We oversimplify. The water, energy, food nexus is a complex matter. The good news is that we know how to address that.
All right. Okay, Mark Terchek. And keep the questions coming, please. Mark Terchek from Nature Conservancy.
Hi. No question. I get to just talk? Great. Hi, everyone. It's
you
nice
get a
to
question
be here.
In a moment.
I run the Nature Conservancy. You may not know us. We're one of the world's big environmental nonprofit organizations. Our mission, we say, is to save the lands and waters that life depends on. We pick those words carefully. So we were the first U.S. land trust, but we diversified over time. So we care about water, marine, climate. And we care about nature because life really does depend on it. So our origins were as a biodiversity organization. So we care about plants and animals, but we care about people too. So again, we want to protect nature because life depends on it. Let me comment on each of the titles of this theme, sustainable agriculture, forestry, and water use, to give you a handle on what we're trying to do. We're a big organization, so we're trying to do things at scale. And again, we want to protect nature. So sustainable agriculture. There's really nothing more important. You've heard already references to the world's going to have to produce 70% more food by 2050 for a growing population and a population that's rising into the middle class. And of course, we're for that. That's an example of people depending on nature. But it's really going to be important for our objectives to see how that happens. So by sustainable agriculture or sustainable intensification of agriculture, what we hope we can help make happen is have agriculture productivity almost double without any expansion of the footprint and while using less inputs all at the same time. That sounds like a heavy lift, but I agree. I think we have every reason to believe we can achieve that. In fact, most of the gaps in the food business they're just inefficiencies. We lose so much food from farm going to market, and in turn, we lose so much food once it comes to market and is wasted. Those gaps we need to close off, I think using technology, ingenuity, business principles, we really can ramp up production. We've had great success in Brazil working with bigger farmers in the soy area, for example, materially reducing deforestation of the Amazon from soy expansion. We're now trying to do the same thing in the cattle space. So we do this with big ag. In places like Colombia, we're working on what's called silvopastoral ranching, where we're bringing forests onto the ranch. It's very cool. I remember the first time I visited one of these ranches, it was very hot. I wanted to go in the shade, so did the cattle. It turns out the cattle like shade, the trees capture moisture, the biodiversity outcomes are very good. This is a great innovation. We're working in Kenya with the Samburu nomadic communities. So these are ranching communities, but how they do their business really matters to environmental outcomes. I think in all those areas we have quite good ideas, backed by good science. It's not so much what to do, it's to scale it up. Our challenge in this area is scaling up best practices as fast as possible, because obviously time's not on our side. And here we are at the COP, climate doesn't help. Forestry. Obviously we care about forests. Again, we want to protect nature. How do we do that? Well, number one, try to slow the expansion of the agricultural footprint. Agriculture's the biggest threat to our standing forests. Number two, can we get people to pay for forests? If people really depend on forests, then they ought to pay for it. You can think of forests and most aspects of nature as infrastructure, green infrastructure in contrast to gray, man-made infrastructure. So many of the world's forests protect our most important watersheds. So we've had a lot of success, first in Latin America, now all around the world, organizing users of water to pay for upstream conservation because it's a lower cost, lower risk way to secure the clean water they need. And for free, we get co-benefits like protecting biodiversity habitat, protecting beautiful places, protecting resources that are vital to the local communities that live there. But that's a big focus of our work. I'll stop with water. water is obviously extraordinarily important here as well. Let me mention one challenge at home. I live in Washington, D.C. today. So we have a problem in Washington, D.C. This is true all over the world. When it rains very hard, we call this extreme weather. That happens more and more often now. I live in Georgetown. Georgetown's kind of downhill. It rains really hard, and all the grime of D.C. flows right into the Potomac River. When it really rains hard, our sewers overflow into the Potomac River. I have a daughter who's a serious triathlete. She came to D.C. for the last D.C. triathlon, but it rained hard the prior couple of days. The river was unhealthy. It became a biathlon. The Potomac flows into the Chesapeake Bay and ruins it. So here's what the Nature Conservancy is doing in D.C. It's another invest in nature idea. We're raising money from institutional investors to bring green infrastructure into the city, green roofs, take vacant lots and make them wetlands. That makes the city act more like a forest. The forest absorbs that intense water and then releases it over time, materially reducing this, this garbage disposal into rivers. We think we can replicate that all over the world. That gives you a sense of who we are. These themes are enormously important. The way we do our work is we try to be collaborative. There are a lot of people we don't agree with on everything, but we try not to start there. We try to say, wait, before we have an argument, let's see if we can find some common ground with entrepreneurs, with big business, with important multilateral organizations, with academics, with indigenous people. We try to find common ground, solve problems, protect nature for many reasons. Environmentalists like us think it's the right thing to do, but it also is natural capital that serves all of us. And this theme is right on the money on all those topics.
Thanks indeed, Mark. It adds a different meaning to the idea of a Georgetown ecosystem. Yes. Normally it's a political system or an academic system. Now it's something rather different, the green roof system. Look forward to seeing it. Do keep the ideas coming through. We've got half an hour to run. We'll finish at 5:20. I just come to you, Patrick. Can I just pick up on a couple of points directly coming into you about tractors and heavy kit on land? Tommy Wells from the director of the Department of Energy and Environment in DC. Have you developed a battery powered tractor? Is one probable? Either a smaller tractor for mowing or a larger one for farming? And there's a similar question, if I can put this to you, from Sarah Ibrahim Malin. Do you see a positive trend for farmers to demand more sustainable tractors beyond fuel efficiencies?
Well, first question, in terms of electric tractors, that is still somewhat in the future. I mean, unlike cars...
How long is the future?
I would have to say probably 15 or 20 years before pure electric. Okay, but there are certain people in the industry working with hybrid concepts today of having, let's say, additional power available by electrics. But today, most or all are working with diesels or making diesels more efficient or methane like ourselves. And we've also been engaged in hydrogen power on tractors. And the big difference between tractors and cars is the need for power is much higher on tractors. And we run our machines at 80 to 100% all the time, unlike cars where you have a lot less power or energy need at the time. And then the second question was, how can we make tractors more sustainable? I mean, we're already doing it. Not only tractors, but also combines, everything else. Every time we make improvements on efficiency, we make it more sustainable, almost by definition, because making them more efficient makes them more sustainable. Again, back to the concept of doing more with less.
Okay. And the economics are driving this, are they? And the technology?
It's both.
Okay, right. Patrick, thanks for letting me do the diversion. Let's move on to impossible foods and where you see things moving.
Okay, I'm going to start with a thought experiment. What if there were a simple way to have a transformative impact not only on climate change but on every major environmental problem we face today in the world? And what if that solution didn't ask individuals or governments to make hard sacrifices but was instead entirely based on making people happier? And what if it didn't require legislation or international consensus, didn't place a disproportionate burden on developing economies, and could actually save the global economy trillions of dollars and happen fast? That sounds impossible, right? But I'll try to change your mind about that. So at this meeting, we're here to talk about climate change, and I'll start with that. According to the UN Food and Agriculture Organization, 1/7 of global greenhouse gas emissions come from animal farming. That's more than the United States emits. And animal farming consumes and pollutes more of the world's dwindling freshwater supply than any other industry on Earth. In 2002, the UN Food and Agriculture Organization estimated that 30% of Earth's entire land area, that's a land area greater than North and South America combined, was actively in use to satisfy the world's skyrocketing demand for meat. And it's only gotten more since then. And according to the World Wildlife Fund, animal farming is the biggest driver of the ongoing mass extinction, the biggest extinction event we've had in hundreds of millions of years. And unlike other major industries, animal farming is completely unnecessary. The plant crops that are harvested this year contain more than enough of every essential nutrient to meet all the nutritional needs of the 9 billion people that we expect to be sharing the planet with in 2050. So, for anyone who cares about the world that our children will inherit, reducing or eliminating animal farming should be goal number 1, 2, and 3. The impact on climate change alone would be enormous. If we could eliminate livestock from our food system, we could actually turn back the clock on atmospheric CO2, something that people rarely even contemplate. And that's because in the past 160 years since 1850, the conversion of forest, savanna, and prairie into grazing and grazing lands and growth of feed crops to raise animals released into the atmosphere 120 billion tons of carbon, which is equivalent to what's emitted at current rates in 14 years by fossil fuels. So if you could snap your fingers and make animal farming instantly disappear, which I'd love to be able to do, the recovery of plant biomass on the land that's currently used to support livestock could remove carbon from the atmosphere equivalent to what's emitted in 14 years by fossil fuels, with no expensive technology required. This is a mature technology, photosynthesis. It's been around for billions of years. And that's equivalent to buying the world 14 years of zero fossil fuel emissions. Unfortunately, you can't just snap your fingers and make animal farming go away. The people around the world love meat, understandably, and we're not going to solve the problem by asking people to sacrifice such an important source of pleasure and nutrition in their lives. But the great thing is we don't have to, because the world's appetite for meat isn't the problem. The problem is how we produce the meat. And for millennia, we've used the same ancient, inefficient, unsustainable technology, farm animals, as a technology for transforming plants into meat. We need to invent a better, more sustainable way to transform plants into delicious, affordable meats that meat consumers actually prefer to anything that we get today from animals. If we could find a way to make meat that consumers value more, then the market will take care of the rest, and animal farming will be gone. And that's exactly what we've been working on for the past 4.5 years at Impossible Foods. It's a huge scientific challenge. It's been taking a team of amazingly talented scientists to figure out how to make meat directly from simple natural plant ingredients that can compete head-to-head with the best meat in the market. And the result is a delicious, wholesome food made by humans with ingredients from nature. No antibiotics, no hormones, no cholesterol, no fecal pathogens. Our first product, which is ground beef, and if you're interested, you can sample it at our booth out there, has a 9-fold lower cradle-to-grave greenhouse gas footprint, a 6-fold lower water footprint, and a 100-fold lower land footprint than the identical product made from a cow. And that's where we are today, but we're just getting started. You know, the cows have been working on this for a million years. And cows and pigs aren't getting any better at turning plants into meat, and we're getting better at it every day. And we'll keep getting better. So the point I want you to remember is that there's now a way to replace the most destructive industry in the world and have a transformative effect on our climate without depending on individuals or governments to make hard sacrifices. And you know, I think this is the reason why the difficulty in contemplating such a possibility is the reason why at a conference like this, where animal farming should be topic number one, because it's the one of the biggest problems and certainly the biggest opportunity for addressing climate change. Nobody's talked about it because they couldn't imagine a way of dealing with it. And so the main message I want to get across to you is, it's a solvable problem. Okay, that's it.
Thanks, Patrick. Olivia, do you want to pick up on... Should I just do a hand, raising hands here? How many people would feel, I'll come to you in a moment, feel comfortable, more comfortable, if animals were not being bred for food? In other words, moving in the impossible foods direction. And those who are prepared, who are determined to stand firm on the principle of eating animal meat. Okay, there is a majority moving in your direction. Ask them for money afterwards. But on 180 million, you're doing pretty well. What would it take to convince the rest of you guys? All right. Olivier, do you want to come in on the principle of such a dramatic shift? And also Mark, we'll just focus on this for the moment. Such a dramatic shift in the way food could be provided quite quickly. And clearly investor interest, overwhelming investor interest.
I think we need to contemplate all options. I mean, like many people are saying. One has to realize that raising animals is part of many people's livelihoods. They've been doing that all their lives, especially small-scale herders, Maasai people, name it. Lots of small-scale herders have been doing that all their lives. If you ask them to stop that business and start producing crops, they may not be able to do it. So when it comes to small-scale herders, I think it's a bit of a challenge, and maybe we should ask them first before taking the decision for them. So, and what I was saying before, this option of, you know, reducing the footprint of the livestock industry can be done in other ways. But I think all options should be explored, because if you have, for example, these insects which also reduce the manure, and then you create compost, and then you also have biogas possibilities, this creates maybe local value chains which can be different from just using plants. I think all options are on the table, and it all often depends on a case by case, but I think what Mark is proposing is primarily, I think, for big farms or big agro industries, whereas for small scale herders, I think we have to be very cautious.
Patrick, just to be clear, do you produce manure as well? Do you produce manure as well?
No, I mean, if there's a demand for it, I suppose we could figure out how to make that too. But I think I just want to address one question, which is that you were suggesting that the idea was to compel people to change their agricultural practices, and that's absolutely not what we're doing. We're creating a new product that consumers can choose to buy or not to buy, and we're not telling anyone, any farmer or any consumer, what choices to make. We're just giving them a choice.
Mark.
Listen, I think...
To do what? Just one question, one thing. Could I just mobilize the microphones, please? There's a lady down here, and it's someone there. So let's get the microphone here. Go ahead.
Okay, a couple of points. One, I mean, Patrick, I think this is really exciting. I happen to be a vegan, so it's easy for me to be for this. But a few things. First, this topic has gotten a lot of attention at COP21, ranching. So you might just be going to different sessions. And in fact, there's a good story there. The ranchers around the world deserve some real credit for working hard to make their own ranching practices more sustainable. So they're trying hard. So they're doing their thing, and that's important. Second, trends change. In America, I think this is right. I think red meat consumption's fallen by about a third in America in the last 10 years. So the world's sort of going this way anyway. I say more power to you. You're absolutely right. Agriculture and cattle are a huge threat to the environment, a huge player in climate. They deserve to be a frontline topic of discussion. And new products like these, I think, should be welcome. And by this environmentalist, they are.
Okay.
Down yes. There. Hi there. I couldn't agree with you
Would
more.
Would you like to introduce yourself, please?
Oh, I'm Marta Gedi. I'm from Maui, Hawaii, with Earth World Solutions. Aloha, everyone from Hawaii. I'd like to agree with you that livestock definitely is a problem, especially with the gas emissions that come out of the cows and whatnot, and the CO2 levels that rise from that. And I do believe that the way in the meat practices, the way that they're doing the way that they're raising their cattle is definitely not only inhumane, but not well for the planet. But my question is when I hear you say that you've mixed plants with science, this you know, my hair stand up wondering if it's GMO at all, because if it is, then that is totally not the solution. I could go into that for a long time, but I won't. But I'm just curious, is there anything, does that have anything to do with genetically modified? And if, okay. And if it's soy, also is my second question, which is mostly genetically modified, which I don't agree with at all.
All right, pass the microphone to your right. GM, Patrick.
We don't need to use any GMO crops to make our product, but our primary goal is to address this huge environmental problem and by pleasing the consumer. So we're really just going to respond to what consumers want, and if they want our product to be made out of GMOs, we'll give them that, and if not, we won't.
That's not really an answer to my question, though.
We don't have a product on the market, so what I'm saying is the products that we'll be making will be dictated by what consumers want to buy.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay.
All right.
Yeah, I get it. Thank you.
The gentleman to your right, in the row before you, is someone there? Forgive me, I can't see hands going up. Yep, I can see two there. So the lady standing up, have you got the microphone? Sorry, you're in the dark.
I've got a microphone. It's Sarah Butler-Sloss from the Ashton Awards. My question would be, surely animals are a key part of the most sustainable form of agriculture. They're a key part in rotation, they're a key part, they play a key role in trampling the land and enriching the soil and bringing more organic matter to the soil. So how, and that also absorbs carbon. So how do you answer that
Before
question?
We go to Patrick, I mean, Olivier, is that what's your answer to that as an agronomist?
No, it's true. It's true. I mean, the manure, we know that it's good for soil if it's well used. I mean, there's also this traditional agreements between farmers and herders in West Africa, for example, with these kind of agreements. You know, I give food, fodder to your animals, but they fertilize the soil. So there's hundreds of years of I think interesting and I think not so damaging. Livestock herding. There's also the issue that you can improve livestock herding digestibility. FAO is working a lot on that. So you can also improve and therefore reduce the environmental footprint. So it's not either or in my view. Thank you.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think it's either or. I mean, even if you're very successful, Patrick, you probably won't put cattle out of business overnight. But looking ahead, as we think about those billions of new people and even more people in the middle class, if they adopt the standard, say, Western diet of today, we're gonna face some huge environmental and climate challenges. So if this product can mean that future diet relies less on red meat and more on this plant-based input, I think from an environmental perspective, that will be a very good thing. In the meantime, though, I think it's also true. Ranching can be done on good sustainable bases, and we wanna encourage that. So I wouldn't lambast the ranching community. I think they're making good efforts, but it'll be great if we have this kind of alternative as well.
Remember, we're talking about this because of land management. Can I just check, Lars, do you want to come in at all on this? All right.
Not really, but I mean, again, as I say, I agree with the panel here that this could be an important contribution, but I think it's also very dangerous to think that it can be all of it. I think it's a very complex question, as mentioned before.
Patrick, we've got two or three more questions
I think,
as well.
First of all, just to be as provocative as I possibly can, I think sustainable ranching is like painless torture. It's an oxymoron. But that could be a very long discussion, which I don't want to get into, but just to get out there. The bottom line is you can talk about all these sorts of theoretical advantages of various forms of farming, but when it comes down to it, if you look at the impact of animal farming on the planet, it's completely unsustainable. And if you look at the environmental footprint of the product we're making right now compared to the same product from a cow, it's vastly lower. 100-fold lower land, 6-fold lower water, 9-fold lower greenhouse gas emissions. That's just the fact. And try to match that with sustainable ranching, I don't think you'll be able to do it.
All right, is there an animal farmer in the room by any chance? I can't. Well, okay. You are. Do you recognize? Can we have the mic? Can we have that microphone over here? Do you recognize these concerns as a farmer? Tell us where you farm, please.
So hi everyone. My name's Josh Gilbert. I'm a farmer from the mid-north coast of New South Wales in Australia. My family have farmed the same land for 40,000 years.
You're a rancher?
Yeah, a beef cattle farmer.
Yeah. How many acres have you got, or square miles?
I've got 100 acres, so it's only small. We primarily deal in climate-wise beef to adapt to the harshness of agriculture in Australia.
What's your reaction to what you've heard Patrick say?
I see some merit in these arguments. I understand that there is this growing trend of people, and I think at the end of the day, the consumer just needs to decide what they're comfortable with. I disagree that farmers haven't been making improvements in this area. We've been doing stuff on our farm for many generations, and I know farmers from right around Australia have been and all around the world, and I think we need to give them credit for that. So,
are you preparing to diversify?
Not on our farm, no. We'll keep breathing climate smart.
Patrick, you were saying you disagree. I just want to make it clear. I totally agree that farmers are making improvements in efficiency and sustainability, as well as ranchers, and they're trying to do their best. I'm just saying that, unfortunately, it doesn't converge on a sustainable solution.
All right. You've got the microphone, and then we'll go to this gentleman next.
Kasper Wanslim from the Forestry and Climate Change Fund. And I was wondering, we're speaking a lot about technology as a solution here and sort of this leap towards a new paradigm. And in our experience, the hardest change is the social practices and evolve them in the interest of what we wanted to achieve. So I wanted to challenge a little bit this technological view, and if you could think about how that was, in your experience, combined with the social practices you see locally and evolve that towards something which is meaningful in the interest of what we are trying to achieve here.
Who do you think that question should go to?
I would be interested in the Nature Conservancy, also in the FAO, but also in the two gentlemen who have proposed technology.
Listen, it's a great observation. You're absolutely right, and there's reason to be encouraged. So I mentioned the Samburu communities in Kenya, where we work with the Northern Rangelands Trust. These are nomadic grazing communities. They're materially changing their grazing practices in order to achieve better grassland outcomes, and they embrace it because it's not that hard for them to understand the objectives and the benefits they get. I mentioned the Colombian ranchers, same thing. Farmers and ranchers have pride in where they live and where they work, and I think, like most people, they're inclined to want to do the right thing. So a role for NGOs like us, or business partners, or multilaterals, is to bring to their attention best practices. Sometimes there's a requirement for a capital infusion, or some know-how. And so there at the Nature Conservancy, we look to the impact investor community to bring in some capital to earn returns, but below market returns, to help us spread those best practices. But then we expect, yes, the local communities, it's their place. They'll be good stewards of it, but we can help accelerate a change in practices. I think there's lots of reason for being confident, and we just heard from one rancher here who takes pride in doing the right thing. I think that's an important ingredient to this work.
Olivier.
No, I fully agree, and I mentioned a couple of examples. If you take this biogas business at household level, the technology is known. The thing is that people might not want to deal with manure and shit, honestly. And so they just don't produce the biogas for cultural or social reasons, which have nothing to do with the technology. And so the subsidies were wrong, because you give them money to build a biogas system that they don't want to use. So it's not just that. But now we're moving into the separation of labor. Farmers do the farming and companies do the biogas. So again, it's not at all has to do with technology. The same for solar energy, for example. Yeah, okay, solar energy, the technology of irrigation is known, solar is known. The problem is, you should not give the energy for free for the reasons I mentioned. But then it requires a bit of an investment. Okay, the prices went down, but for small scale farmers, it's still a big investment to have a solar panel or a couple of panels. So there you need to find a smart subsidy. And I mentioned a couple of possibilities, but this is a topic. Smart subsidies for agriculture is very important. So, and it's nothing to do with the technology. The technology is known. At the same time, it's again not either or, the kind of sophisticated technologies, precision agriculture for large farms, is also important. But also they need to be accepted.
What Impossible Foods are pushing is exactly what is at the heart of the argument that we're trying to get to here. About, is it about making current systems more efficient and viewing things in a different way to embed sustainability across different aspects, or do we need radical innovation, moving away from traditional approaches? We have 6 or 7 minutes to go. Let me come to the gentleman there with the microphone, and then there's another gentleman here. Anyone else at the back who I can't see? Yes, one lady there, please.
Thank you. Jason Pearson, CEO of the Sustainable Purchasing Leadership Council. I just wanted to piggyback on the question of social practices, but not so much from the production side and production practices, but from the side of purchasing and economic demand. What we try to do is bring together the collective demand of government and private sector purchases, very large purchasers who are using procurement departments, procurement professionals, to procure goods and services, including food services, influencing in many cases the very supply chains you're describing. In the coming year, this is very immediate for us, we're going to be challenging those large purchasers to take a limited number of key actions in key areas that we believe will result in their collective economic demand advancing sustainability in the areas in which they act. So my question to you is, from the demand side, what are the actions that you'd like to be seeing that would be promoting the kinds of innovation that you're seeking to develop, that would be promoting the kinds of practices, in the case of TNC, that you're developing?
That's easy. We love when consumers insist on that their suppliers do the right thing. So there are many examples now of big consumer goods company pushing for better practices in their up their supply chain, which is great. Now, there's a lot of work to do, though, because if you take the ag sector, the consumer goods companies aren't the farmers themselves. So we have to take that buying pressure, but help the farmers produce in a way that complies. But consumers can make a very positive difference.
Okay, stop the microphone there. Go.
I should be clear, I'm not talking about individual consumers here. My interest is in institutional purchasers, universities that contract food services, military facilities that contract food services, those hotels, hospitals that contract food services, those types of decisions where you're collectivizing the demand. You don't have to influence 1 million or 2 million individual consumers.
Even better.
I think traceability could be a very, very important topic.
Say that again, can you?
Yeah, traceability could be a very, very important topic here, because the technology already exists today from field to the table to create full traceability of everything that's done in agriculture. So a real requirement for all the suppliers should be full traceability and all to prove that this was produced in the most sustainable way. So I think traceability in all the different levels of agriculture is a key topic that you should be looking into.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I mean, there's a couple of tricky issues in terms of, you know, let's say the trend to say buy two, get the third free. It happens for households, but also for big companies. Or the same thing, you get a better deal if you buy more food, and then a lot of it is lost or wasted. That's one thing that we should work on social aspects, social habits of the consumers. Also, the best before, that's a big issue. You know, expiry dates and all of that. And we're starting a conversation about that. Because honestly, sometimes I eat stuff which is expired and I'm not sick. So that's a big, big debate to have, for example. And we're starting to have a conversation, but you know, you have health issues. Also, another thing you have, I don't know if it's part of your question, but you have people who go to houses, get the food which is just about to be expired, and give it to social services, orphanages, check the quality. It happens in Italy. Very interesting stuff, because people say, oh, it's about to expire, I don't want to eat it. So the people come, get that, and give it to people who need it. Social practice, very interesting. Thank you.
All right, let's get a couple more questions in. Please, the gentleman here, and then that microphone will go immediately back to the lady at the back.
Thank you. Also, I do agree entirely.
Could you just put the microphone up a little bit, please?
With Mr. Brown about the cattling, I would like, I would appreciate Mr. Terzek to explain a little bit more the experience, the Colombian experience of the silvopastoral system, because it's giving us the opportunity to reduce at least 5 times. The land that is being used for cattling, and we are recovering a lot of ecosystems. In the same way, I would appreciate Mr. Dubois to go a little bit further about the possibilities of agroecology, We know that we have a challenge in biological agriculture. We have to go far from the chemical agriculture. And we have experiences that are showing us that we have a good field there.
Thank you very much indeed. Move the microphone back, please.
Okay, I'll be quick. I'm not really the expert, but I've visited this one ranch now 3 times, and a couple of great things happen, but it requires some know-how and some capital. First of all, it's, believe it or not, a forested ranch land, so it just looks different right off the bat. You can imagine big biodiversity benefits, water retention benefits. And the size of the ranch is much small compared to comparable ranches in the same part of Colombia. But that requires very sophisticated grazing. And so there's a series of, I don't know if this is what they call them, but fences kind of. And the cattle, it's more labor intensive, so it's good too. It generates some employment. But there's more labor of moving the cattle around carefully so that you kind of maximize without overdoing it, the grazing. And the sum result is better business outcome, better environmental outcome. But scaling is not so easy. So lots of ranchers visit it. They say, we like this, but they don't know how to get started. They're reluctant to take chances. They don't have the capital or the know-how. So that's the riddle we need to solve. There are the same examples in Brazil at larger scale. So cattle ranching can be intensified. Grazing practices, to the early question, can be improved. There's a lot of science behind it, but spreading the word is a big real-world challenge.
Olivier.
I couldn't agree more. Mixed cropping systems, agroecology, FAO is all for it. There's no problem with that. Crop livestock systems. These systems are more complex, and many farmers actually practice that. But if you want to scale them up, you hit a problem in terms of banks accepting to give you credit for schemes which are rather new or which are complex. They'd rather give credit to something which is monocropping, and that's it, you just go ahead because the results are more predictable. And this, I think, applies because some people were very optimistic in terms of banking is available, financing is available. When something is new, I still need to see, at least in the agriculture field, that the banks will bank new systems. My own experience is very difficult. They will give you a loan for something which is proven. If you try something new, especially in a complicated business like agriculture, they are reluctant to do it.
All right, thanks. Let's get this question here. And there's someone here with a tray here who I think wants to offer you. Shall we offer it to the rest of the panel to see what you think of an impossible burger? You can eat it while you're listening to the next question, as long as you don't choke.
It seems impolite to eat by ourselves. Don't you have some more for the rest of the room?
They can sample it outside. Right. Don't choke as you listen to the next question, please.
Very quick question on that impossible burger. How much does it cost?
It's not commercially available right now. We're just now scaling up to produce it at commercial scale. To produce one of these burgers with our current production process at 1,000 ton a year scale would cost somewhat under a dollar, between 50 cents and a dollar, US dollar.
Very good. I can report.
Okay. Will it be called the Big Impossible? Right, please. There's a lady behind you, just there. Oh, do you want? Okay, who's got it? Microphone, yes, and here.
Hello, Catherine Tay White from Future Eye in Australia. I was keen to hear a little bit more about the role you mentioned, Oliver, about chemicals. I wondered if you could talk a little bit about hormones, additives, as well as chemicals in the production cycle and how important that will be to increase food productivity.
It's not my area of work, but I mean, as an agronomist, I think, of course, it can do it, but you have other ways of doing it. I mean, agroecology, you have other ways of increasing production with a lower footprint.
Patrick?
I'm not sure I completely understood the question. The products that we're making don't involve antibiotics or hormones or any synthetic chemicals, but I don't think that was your question.
All righty. Anyone else want to come in? Right. Who's got the...
So, Kari Dahl, I'm from Sintef Energy Research in Norway, and we just did a project with the Norwegian Farmers Union about introducing low-carbon technologies into the into the agriculture sector. And I just wanted to ask you, because I grew up on a dairy farm with 13 cows, and I don't have this idea that we have to quit meat. And maybe Mr. Dubois, you're the best to answer that question. Is it a position of FAO that we shall exit meat? Is it possible to do that at all? Can we live off plants and insects?
Olivier, has she gone a bit far on that?
Yeah, no, we cannot live just on insects. No way.
People do on television programs.
No, I know. And 2 days ago, there was some chefs cooking some stuff here in Paris and good stuff. For me, again, it's just one option amongst others. But what I like about it is that it's a way to use rubbish in a constructive way, put it this way. Because you destroy part of the rubbish by feeding insects, which can then be used for human food or to feed animals and reduce the environmental footprint. But it's just one option. And it's already done, the consumption of insects by 2 billion people.
Just quickly, all I would say is it doesn't have to be all or nothing. But if in the future humankind chooses to eat less red meat from an environmental perspective, that would be a positive development.
Okay, one more question, please.
Nick, it's to pick up on the question you actually raised about radical and kind of incremental innovation. My name's Ibrahim Mohammed. I work for Climate Knowledge Innovation Community. It's Europe's largest public-private partnership working on innovation. I think there's an interesting pattern coming through here. The innovations are interesting, very good, but incremental nevertheless. Even the very radical change in the food, I'm not sure how really radical it really is. What I think is missing in the discussion is the reform needed in economics, in the way it will guide innovation in the industry and the way it would lead to greater, I think, radical and more coordinated output.
In other words, a new economic model. Is that
new economic model is?
Is that what you assume? Would
fundamental,
assume?
I think.
Lars, are you thinking of that way? As you,
I was thinking. You know, a lot of agriculture around the world is subsidized already. So one way of changing this a little bit is changing the way we do subsidize. Okay, and as we are all agreeing, the technology is already there. So maybe in the future, what we should be thinking about is how can we divert this.
And my point, we look at food waste just as the example, how much of it is wasted? Why is it wasted exactly? Because we need to create an economic value.
People buy too much.
A lot of it is linked to the
Olivier,
economics.
Quickly, because we need to move on.
Right, okay. In developing countries, the food losses happen primarily right after harvest. Drying, storage, transport, it just rots there. It's not consumed. It's not even reaches the shop. In wealthy countries, let's say, in high GDP countries, it's primarily the last stages. You buy too much. It has a small stain, you don't want to eat it. The supermarkets actually don't sell it, they just dump it. So that's more changing of habits, which is, I think, more complicated.
I think there's reason to be encouraged here, and I think you might see radical change in the business community. You see business leaders like Paul Polman at Unilever or Elon Musk at Tesla really pushing the envelope and trying to have their companies do the right thing and also be thriving businesses and a source of innovation. What I think is needed is for more business leaders to step up and be similarly bold. And I think it'll happen because I think they're going to realize it's in their best business interest. Young people today don't want to work for companies with bad values, and consumers won't put up with it either. But all of us have to push. Some of you, I'm sure, are business leaders or investors. We all have to push hard. That's what we try to do at TNC, is push business leaders to be bolder. A lot of them are doing a little bit of the right thing, and we say, no, now you've got to go all the way and do the right thing all the time.
But Paul Polman does have pressure from his board.
Yeah, it's
his,
not easy.
And investors.
It's not easy, so you've got to be brave and courageous.
Returns.
Right.
Yeah. Last word, Patrick. I got to tell you, I wouldn't have known that was an impossible burger rather than an alternative. So in that sense, it's impressive. Your last word about whether you think certainly in this self-selecting group which has gone in your direction, that could be indicative of how the public is prepared to go to support the kind of way in which you are developing new ways of generating an alternative to animal meat.
Everything that we've learned from talking to hundreds of consumers has led us to believe that on the one hand, no matter how much they care about the environment, people are not ready to give up the pleasure of eating meat. And on the other hand,
would they know the difference, do you think?
Well, what I was going to say is what they value in meat is the taste, the deliciousness, and the nutritional value, and the affordability. They don't care that it's made from animals. They've just never had meat that wasn't made from animals. But it turns out that's not part of the value proposition. So I think if we can deliver a product that has all the deliciousness of anything you can get from an animal and is more affordable, I think that we'll do very well in the market. And we'll just have to see how that plays out. But fortunately, it's strictly voluntary. Nobody is compelled to buy our product. We have to do a really great job, and we have to make meat lovers happier than they are today, or we fail.
Thank you very much indeed. And I must say I did enjoy my half of a burger, whatever it was. But thank you very much indeed. Much appreciated. And I'm now going to hand over to Eric Usher from UNEP.